Let's turn tonight in the Word of the Lord to the book of Exodus, chapter number 13. And I want to just read one verse, but I'll be making a lot of reference back to Scripture. And I believe that choir absolutely had it right. Jesus is going to see us through. He's not going to leave us. He's not going to forsake us. I believe He's big enough to get us to the other side. If we could only just see it from His perspective. Exodus chapter 13 and verse number 17. I trust that you're there. Exodus 13 and 17 reads like this, "And it came to pass, when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them, not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest peradventure the people repent when they see war, and they return to Egypt." I want to preach to us for a little while tonight. If the Lord had helped me and the Holy Ghost had anointed me, I want to preach to us on determined despite the detour. Determined despite the detours. Are you going to help me tonight? Okay, I heard you. I'm going to hold you to it. Let's lift up our hands to heaven, church. Let's believe God. Come on, let me hear you pray. Father,
in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. We praise the Lord in this house. We worship God in this sanctuary. We lift up the name of the living God. We pray, God, that you would move upon our hearts' prayers tonight, that the hand of God would touch and anoint every aspect of this service. I can do nothing without you, but I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And I pray, God, Lord, let your anointing rest on this service and meet us around these altars. And we give God the praise and the glory and the honor tonight in the lovely, holy, matchless name of Jesus. And we pray, amen, amen, and amen. Shake somebody's hand that's close enough beside you and smile at them. Tell them, "I'm glad to see you tonight in the house of the Lord." What an amazing thought, brothers. What an amazing thought, dear sisters, that God leads man. That there is a living God that can truly lead every step that man will take if he'll only put God first and let God be God inside of his life. Can you say amen? The old song that we would sing, "He leadeth me, He leadeth me." You know, the Bible speaks of they that are led by the Spirit. They are the sons of God and the children of God. To know that the hand of God can come down and direct our steps according to His will and to put us right in the center of what He desires. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. To know that when I woke up this morning, I came right to this church and began to ask the Lord, "Lord, Lord, let your will be done on earth even as it is in heaven." In other words, God, in this earthen vessel, as you would desire it in heaven, would you let your will be done in my life just like you desire it done there? And I believe God can and will answer those prayers. But the dilemma that we find ourselves in is this. We say, "Well then, Lord, if you're able to lead my life, if you're able to put your hand upon me, then why is all this so seemingly in a confusion? And why does it look like everything's upside down?" The temptation that we fall in is to say, if God is leading me, then why has God led me here? And if God is truly in control, then evidently maybe God doesn't know how to read the map. Let me tell you something, beloved. God has no problem reading the map for your life. God has no problem directing the steps of a good man and to put his steps in heart in order with the work and the will of God. If God is leading us, Brother Zane, how come we found ourselves on this detour? How come we found ourselves in this dry hole? How come we find ourselves in this predicament? Nobody, beloved, nobody. I don't think anybody wakes up and intentionally desires to find a detour that day. think there's a man in here that would ever wake up and say, "Honey, I sure hope traffic is backed up for 45 minutes on the interstate. Pray for me." Honey, you just pray. You just pray that when I get out there, they'll have one of those road construction teams and they will absolutely loop us all around, and before you know it, we'll be in Roanoke before we can come back tomorrow. Just pray I get on a detour today. Nobody likes detours. Nobody likes waking up and seeing that what they had planned from point A to point B now has to be rerouted to point C, D, and F. Nobody likes to look around and say, "Wait a second, how did I find myself here?" But hear me, beloved, if we are to walk with God Almighty, we've got to learn a few things about this walk with God. One of those things is, friend, that God gives a discipline of detours in your life and in my life. It doesn't mean they're out of God's will. It's just a detour that God leads them through. Verse 17, "And it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God let them not through the land, the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest peradventure the people repent when they see war, and they return to Egypt." Verse 18, "And God led the people about." Literally, God led the people in circles. What? Who got us here? You know what the problem is, don't you? It's Moses. Old Mo can't read a map to save his life. I mean, son, if I've ever seen this mound of dirt in this desert before, I've seen it 100 times. And all we're doing is going in circles. And it doesn't seem like I'm making any progress. And it doesn't seem like I'm moving forward. And all it is a detour. And it's a circle. How did I get here? I'll tell you how you got there. You made up your mind to put the Lord first. And God brought you to that place. God brings men in a path sometimes that seems like a circle. I didn't come by tonight to scold somebody if they've been asking God, "Lord, why does it look like I'm running in circles?" I come by the help of God to help somebody in this house to tell you there are times where it is a divine detour that God in His mercy and His love begins to show that man and put that man in a seemingly circle. Though the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, it said the children of Israel went up harnessed out of the land of Egypt. It wasn't a mistake. It wasn't a mistake. It was a divine detour. Friends, sometimes the shortest distance or the longest distance between any two points can be a shortcut. Have you ever seen men and women and they wanted a shortcut in life? And shortcuts cut them short. Come on here, friend. Shortcuts has a way of making you not be able to appreciate the work of God. It takes away from character. It takes away from tenacity. When men and women sometimes are so shown the short path, they do not learn how to lean on God and how to make God their everything. There are times where God has got to take a man and absolutely put him in a circle 150 times, but there's going to come a day where he looks around and says, "I've seen it. I've seen it before. I know it's there, but great God of heaven, I'm still where God wants me to be. And if I see it another 300 times, it's still for my good, because I'm growing and I'm learning and I'm maturing in God. I've seen these 90-day wonders come by. They shoot up like a rocket. They fall like a rock." Son, I mean, man, they can preach like a house of fire. Come on here. I mean, they can shout, make an Indian's blood curl. No offense, Brother Green. Nobody 99% Cherokee with us. Hallelujah. I mean, son, they've got everything just wonderful, but here's the problem. Sister Peach, there's no depth to them. There's no groundness in them. There's no rootedness in them. I mean, so long as everybody's shouting around them, they're the ones shouting the loudest. But what about when nobody's there? What about when nobody's praying around you? God wants you to have some depth about you, to be rooted, to be grounded, to be solid, to be sure. Hear me, young man. It ain't just a youth camp God wants you at. It's at a midweek service where everybody's saying, well, who else is going to get in? You be the one that gets in first. It's not a 100-meter dash. Well, Zane, do we have even in our some of our own? Well, one man said you want me to be polite or honest. I've seen them. Well, they wanted to run the 100-meter dash. And as soon as they felt like they were in front of the crowd, they could turn around and say, look, I'm in front of everybody else. Let me tell you something, beloved. That ain't how Brother Zane works. That ain't how these preachers work. This thing ain't a 100-meter dash. You don't know what this thing is. It's a relay race. I take what I have and I give it to another. And then that other one takes what he has and gives it to another. And we're running in this thing together. And it ain't a one-man show, but it's a team. It's an army. It's a body. Say amen. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. There's times God pulls you back because he sees you're just not ready to handle that battle. God said, I can't have them go that way yet, lest they see those Egyptians. Fear gets all over them. And they turn back in the day of battle. I know we don't like to admit this sometimes. Let me tell you something, friend. There are some battles that you're just not ready to take on. I'm in my 30s. I can see things now, and I can face things now that I promise you I could not have faced as a man in his 20s. And I have no doubt that when I turn 40s, and 50s, and if the Lord should tarry how long, that there will be things that I'll be able to face as a 50-year-old man. There ain't no way I could have faced as a 30-year-old man. Brother Smith, God knows what you can take. He knows where the limit is, and He knows where the line is. And there's sometimes it seems like a detour, and all it is God saying, you're just not ready for that battle. Oh, the brother saying, I can take on anything. He's wiser than you. He knows more than you, and He knows what you can handle. There's times I look back, Brother Pete, and I'm glad God did send me on that detour. I wasn't ready for that. I couldn't handle that yet. I mean, God knows I can't have them take that shortcut. If they get out of my wheel and try to grab for it too soon, they're going to find they're going to find that the enemy's on this side and that side, and they haven't prepared their heart for it yet. Come on here, friend. God knows the battles that we need. God knows the battles that we can take. I'm so glad that God knows what I can take. Lord, you know where I am. God, you know what I can handle. He's still leading. Say amen. Wilderness was that boot camp for them. Here's a place God could toughen them up some. Here's a place God could mold them. Here's a place. Here's a place where some of them were so ready to jump out front and get ahead. And the Lord's letting them know, hear me, you're just not ready for it. Let me tell you something, young man. Let me tell you something, young lady. Before you're ready to get out there and be a worldwide evangelist, here's the first thing you got to pass. Are you faithful to your own home church? Amen. You heard about that one man. He said, what are you going to do? man said, well, I feel like being a missionary and go overseas. He said, well, what are you doing right here? He said, well, I ain't doing nothing right here. He said, then please don't go overseas and do the same. Say amen. I said, say amen. If you can't be faithful to God in your home church, you ain't going to be faithful to God when you get away. There is a testing. There's a learning. There's a supplementing. There is a submitting of your soul to the will of God here. Worst place you can get into is when you determine your heart, I'm going to get ahead of the plan that God wants for me. That's a tough place for a preacher to be. I mean, you can see it. You know it needs to take place. You know as good as I do, here's what needs to happen. Somebody needs to take that other person by the nap of the neck and just lift them up straight and give them a 150% straight talking to. And in the name of Jesus, and then send them on their way, and everything will be worked out. But you know as good as I do, if you try to do that, you're going to tear up some wheat with the tares, and God's got to give you wisdom, and you've got to say, I can't just get up and jerk everybody up by their collar. I got to have wisdom. I got to know what to do, and there's got to be a timing with God. Timing is more important than time. Green God says, no, it's not my timing yet. You can't do that yet. You just got to keep walking with Him. Beloved, hear me. That should be a blessing, not a discouragement. Because in today's world, you know what we feel? Here's what we're being indoctrinated with, pushed every day. Here's what a successful ministry is. Day one, you start here, and then it goes just like this. And that's success. Now, here's life. Yeah. Come on here. Friend, hear me. For the children of Israel, success was not a straight line shooting up. And God help us understand today, the most important thing is not saying, am I success? The most important thing is saying, God, am I still got my eyes on the Lord? Exodus 13 and 21, the Lord went before them in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and a pillar of fire to give them light the day and the night. He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, the pillar of the fire by night. You want to know what that pillar was? It was the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah! That Passover lamb represented Christ. But now that they're delivered, He's saying, if you want me to lead you, you keep your eyes on me. Quit worrying about the direction. The most important question is my eyes still on God? Is my heart still on God? I may have walked around 5,000 times, but I gotta know, Lord, are you still leading me? Most important question. Not are you making progress. Most important question is, Lord, am I still following that cloud? Oh, hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Moses, you get up that morning. Brother Green, he looked around. If that cloud was overhead, he'd say, boys, we ain't going nowhere. He'd get up one morning, that cloud would be down that road. Pack them up, boys. We're going to follow that cloud. What? Wait a second. We only been here a day. That's all right. I'm following the cloud. If the cloud says go, I go. If the cloud says stay, I'll stay. But I got to follow Him. I got to be led. I've got to know I'm walking with Him. I just want to know. I'm talking to somebody in this house tonight. The most important question is not are you progressing? Are you a success? Does somebody think highly of you? The most important question is, am I letting God lead my life? Am I really? That's why it's so important. That's one of the many reasons why it's so important that you get full and stay full of the Holy Ghost. Brother James, you asked the Holy Ghost to go to heaven. That one man said, I wouldn't go to the post office without the Holy Ghost, let alone heaven. Here's a better question. Do you want to be led by God? Do you want to be led by God? Do you finally want to come to the place in your life where you say, Jesus, hallelujah, thank God that when I got saved, you gave me the Spirit. But God, when I got baptized in the Holy Ghost, I gave myself to the Spirit. Hallelujah. At salvation, I possessed Him. But hallelujah, when He filled me with the Holy Ghost, He possessed me. Glory unto God. He leads me. He guides me. He directs my soul. Well, so-and-so, they must have made a wrong turn going there, going here. Why? Because they sure were making more money over at the other place. That's not the litmus test. Here's where people make mistakes. When they quit following the cloud. They quit letting God lead their lives. God, hear me. Friend, hear me. There's times. Where God Himself will send you on a detour. Your job is not to determine whether or not you're going in circles. Your job is to keep your eyes on the cloud. Friend, yes, there is that discipline of detours. But God's Word tonight lets us know, ouch, it gets worse. Because there's also a dilemma. Dead ends. And if you think detours are aggravating, I promise you dead ends can be overwhelming. We was going up the road one time, and in fact, we were going to North Mississippi to preach. We're in Batesville. And it's the first time I've ever been there, and I got this brand new little gadget called a GPS. Second most frustrating invention right behind that cellular telephone. I was so excited. I even put it on a little British accent. How about them apples? Come on. She'd say, turn left. I'd say, good day. My wife says, don't you think we ought to call the pastor just to make sure? Oh, babe. You don't have to worry about that, okay? Quit elbowing your husband's wife, you know. A healing line for bruised ribs when this night's over with. And we turn left, and we turn right, and man, I mean, son, you want to talk about sticks, hicks and sticks. And I mean, we are furthest thing away. And about that time, that little lady on the GPS goes, arriving at your destination on the right. And I look, and there ain't nothing out there. Erica looks at me and smiles. She says, you reckon this is the church? I said, no, baby. This is where drug dealers throw dead bodies. I'm scared. Call the pastor. Amen. But nobody likes to be led to a dead end. Nobody. Nobody likes to hear, this is it. It's a wall. Exodus 14 and 8, and the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And he pursued after the children of Israel. And the children of Israel went out with a high hand. But the Egyptians pursued after them all the horses and the chariots of Pharaoh and his horsemen and his army. And overtook them camping by the sea beside Pahairoth before Baal-Zephon. When Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes. And behold, the Egyptians marched after them. They were so afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Therefore hast thou dealt with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? It had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness. There's a mountain to the left, a mountain to the right, a sea behind me. And here's Pharaoh. His sword is glistening in the sun, and his eyes are full of blood. And everybody's pointing fingers and saying, who got us in this place? I tell you who got you there. God Almighty. Oh, glory to God. God led them there. God put them in that place. God trapped them in. God got them in a position where they had mountains on both sides and obstacles on the other. And they cried unto the Lord. Thank God for when men call on the Lord. God, not the devil, not even Pharaoh, God put them to a place where they were trapped in a dead end. It's Moses' fault. It's his fault. It's her fault. No, no. Rather than pointing a finger, you ought to be praising the Father. God, you brought me to this dead end in my life. Friend, that aggravation became desperation. Exodus 14 and 2. I told you I'd be reading a lot of scripture tonight. Speaking to the children of Israel that they turn and encamp before Pihahiroth. Between Migdol and the sea. Verse number 3. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land. The wilderness has shut them in. Exodus 14 and 4. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And he shall follow after them. Listen. And I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his host. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. And they did so. Friend, whenever God brings you to that place where it's literally a brick wall or a sea, God always has a greater plan that will involve your good and His glory. And beloved, if all it is your good without His glory, walk away from it. It ain't His plan. If it's your good without His glory, it's only half baked. It's got to be both. Lord, it's going to work for my good, but it's going to be for Your glory. My God, can you imagine if there would just been another path? We never would have had a story about how God's able to open up a Red Sea. The army of Pharaoh would never have been destroyed. And the testimony that God is greater than the enemy, which still been in Old Testament Israel's mind, a question mark. Thank God for the dead ends that He puts in our lives, brother. Thank you, God, for the dead ends that break me down to where I've got nowhere to turn but God. I think I'm boring some of you here tonight. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which He will show to you today. I love this. For the Egyptians, and ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. Hallelujah to God. The Egyptians that you saw, He said, you see them never, never, never again. There comes a place where God says, that's as far as you're going to go. That's as much as you're going to torment them. Yes, they may have been at a dead end, but I heard their cry. I heard their plea. I'll open up a Red Sea. I'll make a path. I'll show my glory. Amazing thing. A man by the name of John Bright wrote a book entitled A History of Israel. It wasn't taken from a Christian perspective. It's just an absolute history of Israel. It's a terribly boring book if you're not interested. But there was one little section in there that I found fascinating. It said, to this day, although with all the other surrounding nations, hieroglyphics show of all of Pharaoh's army going into that Red Sea and drowning. But as of this day, no archaeologist has ever never discovered or uncovered any of the Egyptian tombs that ever show their own defeat. I smiled and said, well, you know what? If I was a devil, I wouldn't have been too proud of it either. But it happened. Hallelujah. I said it happened. Every other nation around there, let them know that it happened. But old Egypt's still trying to cover it up. I thought about Calvary. I said, I think hell's still trying to cover it up. But thank God he came out of the grave and he's victorious and he's king and he's able to help. Say amen. Well, Satan, what do you think I ought to do when I'm at a dead end? I tell you what I think I ought to do. I think I ought to stand still. I think I ought to fear not. I think you ought to see the salvation of the Lord. Honey, what are we going to do? Nothing. You've heard me say this before. How's that place a few months ago now? In fact, we had a week off. We were up there in Ohio at my in-laws. I called up a dear friend of mine, Brother Kevin Lloyd. I said, Brother Lloyd, I need you to do me a favor, pal. What's that, Brother Zane? I said, I need to borrow your church. I said, you want to come preach for us? I said, I ain't want to talk about it. I said, me and God, I got to get along with God tonight. I got to get along with God. He said, you come on back, son. Come on back. I told my bride, I said, I feel like I got to get an answer. There's just something pinning in my heart. I got to get an answer. And I cried to God that night, called on His name. And I come back in about 5 or 6 in the morning that next morning. My precious bride looked at me and she said, honey, did you get the answer? And I said, Erica, I did not get the answer, but I did get the assurance. Hallelujah. My God, I don't know what's going to happen, but all I know, He said He's going to be with me. Hallelujah, my God. I don't know what's going to happen, but oh, hallelujah. All I know, He's going to stay beside me. He ain't going to forsake us. He ain't going to leave us. He's going to take my hand. I don't know what's going to happen on the other side, but all I know is I walked away with an assurance that He's God. That He's God. That He's God. Somebody praise Him. Somebody worship Him. Hallelujah. Bless His name! Glory! Glory! I don't have the answer, but thank God I know the answer. I got close. You give me a few more minutes here tonight. There's detours. God, there's some dead ends. Dead ends. But this is what gets most of us. This is what gets most oldest folks right here. It ain't the detours. It ain't the dead ends. It's the dry holes. Exodus 15 and 22. Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. And they went out into the wilderness of Shur. They went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. We can take a detour. As long as we feel like we got the prayer team right beside us. We can take a dead end. As long as we get 3 phone calls a week from the pastor. But what about when you hit the dry hole? What about when there's no water? It seems like flowing over your soul. What about when you come down to this altar and it's just as dry as cracker juice and you walk back and you never got a chill down your spine? Are you still going to hold on to God and say, I'm determined to get where God wants me to go? The shouter don't come on them about once every 3 weeks. They're liable to leave us. The runner don't come on them once. I'm for every shout. I'm for every run. But what about when you find yourself in the dry place? Are you still determined Are you still determined? Are you still determined to find your way to the finish line? Hallelujah to God. I told somebody just the other day, I was there in Sweden, and in the last few days, some of the brothers from the church want to go over to Norway, and we happened to stop by a little place, and I didn't know they was having a marathon that day. And we looked at the marathon runners for a second, and I said, I don't know where the finish line is, but I can tell you one thing, it's got to be close. He said, Brother Zane, why you say this, brother? Brother, why you say this? And I said, look at their face. At the starting gate, it's full of enthusiasm. But only those that are full of determination are going to get to the finish line. I thank God for every time I feel whatever I feel. But, mister, I didn't get in this thing because of feelings, and I ain't getting out because of a feeling. I know in whom I have believed. Oh, my God. I know in whom I have believed. I am persuaded. You ain't got to play my favorite song. You ain't got to pat me on the back. I am persuaded that He's able to keep what I've committed. Somebody praise Him! And if I don't ever get a phone call, I'm still trusting Him. And if I step behind that pulpit, and I know I've prayed, and I know I've asked God for the help, and it still feels like I've got 1,000 pounds on my shoulders, I'm going to keep walking with Him. I pulled and pushed, twisted, tugged, did everything I could. And they still as dead as 4 o'clock in the morning. Well, Brother Zane, what if they run me out of town for preaching it? Then, mister, you leave that town like you lead in a parade. You hold your head up and you say, I'm trusting God. And God's going to make another way. And God's going to open up another path. And it may be dry now, but it ain't dry forever. You got to understand what's going on. I know it's getting late, but I feel like preaching, sorry. You got to understand what's going on right here. 15 and 23 of Exodus, when they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters, for they were bitter, verse 24. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? You got to understand, Deuteronomy 8 and 2 explains it for us. It says, the Lord thy God led them 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee. Listen. To prove thee and to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep His commandments or not. They didn't get there because Moses was a bad leader. They didn't get there because God was inadequate. They got to a place that was dry because God said, I've got to see what's really in their heart. Young person, God allows you to go to that dry place because He's going to find out and show you what's really in. To prove thee, to test thee. Literally, to test thee. The Bible says to prove. It's a synonymous term in the Hebrew. To test thee. It was as if God was passing out a test. No cheating. Turn your papers over. When you're done, just simply raise your hand and I'll come and collect them. My brother's a school teacher. He teaches gifted and talented kids. Super brainiacs. You can give them a trigonometry problem. I can't even pronounce the thing. Man, they go to town. You give them a ball and they look at you funny, you know. But he says, you know, every now and again, one of those kids, they fail the test. I say, what do you do? He said, oh, it's easy. I just give them a retest. It's the same thing, but they got to pass it. Why does that person keep doing that to me? I had a pastor friend tell me, he said, for years, said there was one man in that church that was forevermore cantankerous. And he got down, he prayed, he said, Lord, how long are you going to let this one man forevermore get underneath my skin and cause so much problems? And as he's wailing to God, he said, I felt the Holy Ghost say back to me, until it quits bothering you. How long are you going to let this man keep doing it to you? You get to the place where it doesn't bother you anymore. I'm scared to turn my back to you right now, so I'm backing up slowly. And there are tests that some people have to go through over and over and over again till they get it right. Friend, I pray you pass the test. I pray you pass the test. I pray you pass the test. I got to close. There's so much more I want to get into. I don't have time to give you all this, but Exodus 16 and 8, it speaks of, and Moses said that your murmurings are not against us, but against the Lord. In other words, they're looking. Here is Moses. It's God's gift to the people. And they're looking at God's gift and they're saying, it ain't good enough. It ain't good enough. Paul's talking to the Corinthians, and he's kind of giving these Corinthian believers kind of a history lesson in 1 Corinthians 10. You don't have to turn there, but he speaks about what happens in that wilderness, and he speaks about how some of them were overtaken, and that we should not follow their examples. They were idolaters. They lusted. They had fornication. They were people that tempted one another. And in the midst of that list, he says, and neither murmur ye, that some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. In other words, he puts murmuring in the very same list that he puts fornication, lusting, tempting, and idolatry. Murmuring. I'll tell you something, beloved. When you look at the provisions that God's given you, you still with me? And you say, I just don't like the pastor that we have. I just don't like the song leaders that we have. I just don't like the Sunday school and the way it's going. And I just don't like every musician that we have. That's not what you're really saying. Here's what you're really saying. I just don't like the provisions that you've put over me. God, your provisions are inadequate. You say, Brother Zane, that's pushing it a little too extreme. No, sir, it's not. When you murmur against the provisions of God, you're murmuring against the God of the provision. God, I pray you pass the test. Sister Erica, would you help me? What happened, Brother Zane? I'm closing this account tonight. In Exodus 15 and 24, the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? And in verse 25, and he cried unto the Lord, listen, and the Lord showed him a tree. When he had cast into the waters were made sweet. There he made for them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them. The whole time they're murmuring, the tree's there. God didn't form a tree. God didn't happen to snap a tree into existence. He happened to tell old Moses, look, tree's right there. And if you'll just put that tree in the middle of your bitter water, it'll make it sweet. You may think I'm pushing this too far, but I do not. I believe that tree speaks of what Jeremiah spoke of when he said, the righteous branch Peter tells us that Jesus died upon a tree. I believe it's a foreshadowing of Calvary. And I believe God is saying, if you'll just put Jesus in the middle of your bitter water, it'll be enough to get you through. If you'll just put Jesus in the middle of that dead-end situation, if you'll just put Jesus in the middle of that dry hole, if you'll just put Jesus in the center of that detour, it'll make it sweet enough, it'll make it a provision enough, and it will be all that you need to make it through. I believe God's brought a preacher by the night to tell somebody, it's time you put Jesus back in the middle of your dry place, of your dead end, of your divine detour. And the prayer is not, God, if you'll just get me out of this. The prayer is, Lord, if you'll just get in this with me. Oh, God. If you'll just get in this with me. I'm not asking to get you, because God, you have a timing that I don't even see. I'm not asking you to get me out of this. I'm asking for you to get in this with me. And Lord, just be beside me. And when it's your time, I'm coming on up. And when it's your time, I'll come on out. But until then, I'll hold on to the old rugged cross. Stand with me all over this house tonight, church. Somebody slip up your hand to heaven and say, Jesus, let me put Jesus in the middle of my life. Let me put Jesus in the middle of everything. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added. Just over the hill. They couldn't see it. Brother Smith, they didn't know it's there. But just over the hill. It's a beautiful oasis, Exodus 15 and 27. And they came to Elim, where there were 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees. And they encamped there by the water. God hadn't forsaken them. Talking to somebody, my God, help me, Holy Ghost. You're in this house and you say, Brother Zane, it feels like I've been going in nothing but circles. I feel like I've been spinning in circles. I just need God's help tonight. You hear me, friend? God is here to touch your life. And I know the modern day evangelist, I know. They're supposed to come by and tell you that God's going to bring you out of this valley. Tomorrow everything's going to be different. But you that know Brother Zane good enough. And I didn't come by to tell you God's going to bring you out of every heartache and pain. But I have come by to tell you He is a God that will stay beside you and be with you and go before you and never leave you and never forsake you. And you'll be victorious. I don't know how many of you feel tonight like you're at a dead end. I don't know how many of you tonight feel like you're in a dry hole, but there is a God that specializes in refreshing, restoring, and renewing. I know there's hearts all over. I don't even have to ask for hands to be raised. I don't have to ask for people that would. I know all the way from the back to the front there are needs inside this house tonight. I'm going to ask every last one of us that would, can we step up from where we're standing? Can we make our way in around these altars tonight? And can we pray, Jesus, would you just come in the middle of this with me? Let me put you first, oh God. Let me make God first tonight. Come on, all the way from the back to the front. Let's strip those pews and find an altar of prayer and let Him be first.